I'm Malcolm Rosholt. I'm standing on my land in the northeastern corner of the town of Alvin in Portage County, and I want to tell you about my woods. When I hear the wind blowing here, I think of Longfellow's Evangeline. This is the forest primeval, the murmuring pines and the hemlocks. Well, we don't have too many hemlocks left, but we do have a few white pines. These are all second growth timber, of course, but the forest is something that lives, we're born, it lives, it dies, and I can't think of a better example of that than this big white pine in back of me. When I bought this land 25 years ago, this was a beautiful tree, almost 100 feet high, but age crept up on it, just like it does with people. And first thing you know, that a top broke off, and a few years later, a big branch broke off in a heavy wind, and now you see what's left of this tree, one big branch, actually a hazard. This is the ecology, and we talk a great deal about virgin timber. There was no virgin timber, it was prehistoric timber. After all, this timber had been growing here for thousands of years. So when the pioneers came here, they call it virgin timber. And altogether, I think we'll have something that'll be of interest to you, because we're going to mix up these on-site pictures with photographs taken 100 years ago.
Before 1836, there were only a few up and down sawmills in Wisconsin Territory. Logging operations did not begin on a large scale until after 1836, for in that year, the federal government purchased all the lands held by the Menominee Nation east of the Wolf River, but the Menominees still held claim to all the land lying to the west of the Wolf as far as the Wisconsin River. In order to open the Wisconsin River Valley to lumbering, the Menominee leaders agreed to sell a strip of land along the river 6 miles wide, or 3 miles along either bank, extending from the Coosa north 50 miles to Big Bull Falls, later known as Wausau. Within a year after this treaty was made, lumbermen hurried north from Portage City to gain squatters' rights to the best rapids near Wisconsin Rapids, Stevens Point, Mosinee, and Wausau. George Stevens, from the state of New York, went the farthest north to build a mill at Big Bull Falls, where he began building in 1839. By the end of 1840, rafts of lumber were being floated down the Wisconsin from all these points and on to the Mississippi River, down to the lumber yards at St. Louis, Missouri. But first, the government had to have the land surveyed into townships and quarter sections in order to get a legal description that would be binding on seller and buyer. The survey of the 6 mile strip on the Wisconsin River was let out on bids, and Joshua Hathaway, seen here, an Easterner living in Racine, won the bid. He came north from Portage with a cart or wagon pulled by a yoke of oxen, hauling his instruments, supplies, tents, and blankets. He was assisted by a crew that probably included an axeman, chainman, flagman, and a cook who could double as an ox teamster. And here is a compass resembling the one used by Hathaway. It is an antique discovered by Tony Kedreski, a surveyor from Portage County. This mock survey footage was taken only a short distance from the point of beginning on the south line of present Wood County, where Hathaway began his survey in 1839 on the banks of the Wisconsin River. Incidentally, the Hathaway crew began work in late February, but by midsummer had to suspend operations after the crew became disabled by poison oak. This was apparently a leaf none of them had ever encountered before they got to the swamps of Wisconsin Territory. Work was resumed in the fall of 1839, and by the winter of 1840, Hathaway had reached Big Bull Falls, the end of the 6 mile strip. Before 1890, the tall pines were chopped down with axes by pairs of men swinging left and right-handed. These men drew top pay, for they were the kings of the woods. This photo, taken in 1864 and reproduced as an engraving in Harper's Magazine, shows two sawyers bucking up a log with a cross-cut saw. This early saw had no raker teeth and could not be used for felling trees because the teeth clogged with sawdust. In small camps, the saw filer would touch up the saws in the woods, as shown here. And here we can see a modern cross-cut saw developed in the 1870s. The addition of raker teeth allowed these saws to be used for felling trees, a job previous to this development that was performed by the choppers. The double teeth are the cutters and the single teeth the raker. As seen here, this tree has been scribed. That is, the bark has been chipped off with an axe all the way around the trunk to save the sawyers from having to saw through a heavy layer of bark. The string in the middle holds a wedge which is driven into the kerf made by the saw blade to keep it from pinching. After a tree was sawed down, it was sawed into lengths usually of 16 feet. This was called bucking up a log. The two sawyers were working for Moore and Galloway Company in Marathon County. The lumberjacks who cut the trees in the forest also lived in the forest, usually in shanties made of logs. This historic photo was taken in the spring in 1891 by William Parks of Iola, but the camp was located 25 miles northwest of Iola at the upper dam on the Little Wolf River. Skidding logs out of the forest was done entirely by oxen at this time, and there are at least five yoke of oxen in this picture, all with horns. But there was no danger. The oxen were gentle if treated with a firm and even hand. This type of log construction was a favorite before 1900. It was easy to build and almost entirely of logs with pantile roofing. The stable for the oxen was at the right and the sleeping shanty and kitchen at the left. The open area in the center, called a dingle, was used to store supplies for the crew and hay and straw. This 1870s photo shows a camboose, a word that comes to us from Canada. The camboose was an open fireplace in a sand pit in the middle of a shanty. A hole in the roof allowed the smoke to go out and the cold to come in. This arrangement was being used as late as the mid-1870s in a camp north of Stevens Point.
The thermometer is an instrument that was not found in the logging woods. The loggers got along without it. What they didn't know, they said, didn't hurt them. And anyway, it didn't matter how cold it was, they always were out in the woods working. The only reason they didn't go out after it got 25 below zero was because of the horses.
Dinner in the woods away from camp became an early tradition. This photo was taken on January 19, 1892 in the Rice Lake area for Knapp Stout and Company. This photograph with a round frame was taken on one of the early Kodaks manufactured by the Eastman Company of Rochester, New York. The cook and his assistant, called a cookee, wait for the crew of hungry men. The kitchen walls are decorated with old newspapers, cartoons, and pretty girls. The lumberjacks at supper. Talking was not allowed at mealtime because the cooks wanted the men in and out. Notice the kerosene lamps. This is a triangle or dinner bell, but in the logging camps referred to as a gut hammer.
At this point, I'd like to introduce my associate, Mr. Craig Anderson, who lives here in the village of Rosholt.
In addition to the gut hammer, in some logging camps, a horn like this was used to call the men in to dinner.
This horn is called the Gabriel, after the angel Gabriel. And it sounded something like this.
Interior of a bunk camp shows two tiers of bunks parallel to the outside wall. The men are seated on the deacon's seat, four with shoe packs. But the two in the center wear caulked boots, usually not allowed inside, but an exception was made for this picture taken near Cable, Wisconsin about 1905. A camp on the Flambeau River. One of the largest logging camps built in Wisconsin, this one for the Drummond Lumber Company of Drummond. This temporary logging camp was built of logs and covered with tar paper. The hole in the roof was for light, not smoke. Malcolm is now going to interview Mr. Albert Check of the town of Sharon in Portage County. Mr. Check will recall some of his experiences while working for the Yawkey Bissell Lumber Company of White Lake, one of the last big logging camps.
And tell us how you got the job and what you did in this camp, Mr. Check, please.
Well, the way I got started, my cousin Hank Check got me in to get a job. Mm-hmm. We started off $1 a day and board.
And what year was this?
Pardon me?
What year?
1939. Mm-hmm. And we worked, there was no such thing as 8-hour shift. We worked from dark till dark. And then I worked in the woods for a while. Then they needed a helper in the kitchen, so I got in as a second cook at White Lake.
How many people were in the camp?
There was usually about 100, 110, and then they had a fellow that was jobbing for the company. He had about 30 men on his own.
I see. Well, who was the camp woods boss when you were in that camp at Camp 17?
Camp 17.
Who was the boss there?
Old John Collins.
Collins.
They used to call him Coughing John because he never wanted to walk on a man not working hard enough, so he kept on coughing. And if he wanted to catch somebody, then he didn't cough.
You were sleeping in the sleeping shanties, bunk shanties?
Double bunks.
Double bunks.
With a lot of bed bugs in them.
Is that so?
That's right.
Well, did you have any springs or just mattresses on
just
boards?
Just mattresses.
On the boards?
On boards, that's right.
Yeah. And then the cook shanty was separate.
Right next door.
Mm-hmm. What did you have for supper, ordinary meal at dinner time? Did they bring the food to the woods?
When we worked in the woods, they brought it to the woods.
And what did they usually bring at noon for you? What did they usually?
Oh, they usually had a good roast, all sliced up. They brought them in. They had those hot jugs or containers.
Yeah.
And they had potatoes and gravy, coffee, bread. We always got plenty to eat as far as eating. We always had vegetables. And evening, when we came, we waited. Well, usually supper was around 5:30 or so after it got dark.
Yeah.
We couldn't wait to get in the kitchen. That's how hungry we were.
Yeah. And how much were you making, you said?
$1 a day and board. And when I got in the kitchen, second cook, I got $60 a month.
Well, you doubled your wages.
Double, yes.
Is that so? And well, what did the first cook make?
The first cook made, I think, 120 a month.
And the Teamsters, how many? Did you have any Teamsters?
We had